KI Kompakt, die Podcast-Serie über künstliche Intelligenz.
Herzlich willkommen zur heutigen Ausgabe von KI Kompakt. Mein Name ist Andreas Götte und wir beschäftigen heute uns mit dem Thema die Zukunft von künstlicher Intelligenz. Welches sind die aktuellen Entwicklungen im Bereich KI auf dem Softwaremarkt, aber auch in der Gesellschaft, Herausforderungen, Trends und auch die Innovationen und die Entwicklungsschwerpunkte, die wir im Markt heute wahrnehmen? Und hierzu habe ich einen sehr spannenden Gast heute zu mir eingeladen, den Herrn Shadi Shaheen. Er ist Vice President und Head of Product Strategy bei SAS. Herzlich willkommen, Shadi. Welcome, Shadi.
Thank you very much, Andreas.
Yeah, happy to have you here in my podcast. So can you, for kind of introduction, can you say some words on what drives you personally and what led you to join SAS?
Well, thank you again. My background has been in technology for the past 20 plus years, from being a hardware and software engineer and then moving into leadership positions in software companies mostly. And I've always been drawn to technology, drawn to the hard challenges of technology. And back in the day when I started working on printers, it was interesting. But the more interesting part when the printer industry evolved into the digital document management or interpretation of data, that's always been a draw for me. And those are the things that I've been attracted to and drawn to. So driven to find areas of technology that have been complex historically for the end user population and simplifying, accelerating. And the draw at SAS has been to come to a company that defined a market in analytics and potentially became a little unfocused in becoming maintaining its role as the disruptor and creator and bringing that back in. And that's what drives me, coming back in and being the disruptor in a marketplace that's rapidly evolving, that's growing, but growing in all directions and bringing some sense of rationale and direction into it. And that's what drives me. The hard things are things that make me get up in the morning and come to work early and leave late, because there's a demand. A lot of people are working on the problem. Can we bring some sanity to the problem and the solution and get ahead of where people want to be, need to be, to guide them there? So those things that drive me, and data has been a passion of mine. And it seems like this would be the right fit for me, leaving a company like Red Hat, which is in the heart of bleeding edge technology, but guided by where the community is going and kind of coming to a company that has led the way in analytics and more broadly technology, and now figuring out what that evolution looks like.
Okay, cool. The disruption is a good keyword. Obviously, we are talking mainly on AI, analytics-driven AI. So this is entering or changing all areas of life in all industries mainly. What is your view on artificial intelligence in general? Where are we in 2019, and what are the trends for the next years from your perspective?
I think from a personal standpoint, we are in the days of demystifying what AI truly means. It's a big word. Right. And people's image of artificial intelligence is mostly guided by the cinematics of it. Right. Walking and talking androids and things that feel very much like science fiction, when the reality of it is it's pervasive around us, whether it's through virtual assistants, virtual assisted driving or with it's my laptop, my phone. It's around us and it's real. It's not science fiction. And I think this is the year we demystify it for the end user and we demystify it for companies. Organizations are trying to figure out how they either get a slice of the pie in this AI market or leverage what AI brings to them, whether it's in manufacturing or consumer electronics or in more agrarian industries. And that's one part of it. And there's fear on the other side of people who are being impacted by AI, whether they're end users or their commodities, saying, is that going to displace me? Is that going to invade my privacy, whether it's through home automation or virtual assistants? And And this is the year, and I think it probably is going to take us this year and next to rationalize and maybe not dumb down, but like I said, demystify what it truly is. It's based on these analytical techniques, right? We've talked about machine learning for years. This is, we've rebranded it. Data science and deep learning, those things have been around. And now we have a forcing mechanism of a populist movement and understanding it. And I think it'll become clear to people what it is and what it isn't. And then we can actually then take action on it. And people will start using probably different words around augmented analytics or acceleration of analytics versus just artificial intelligence, because again, we are making that more real to the industry and more real to the people.
Yeah, so demystifying is a really important from my perspective. So if you view a little bit in the enterprise world, so in the business world, what do you expect? What are the most relevant use cases in the next 2 years, where we as a company and also the companies from a maturity perspective will focus on?
So I'll take a look at two different areas of this. There are the purveyors of information and analytics, and there are the consumers. On the people who want to leverage AI to be part of the things they do and provide and build, we will see a lot around assisted augmented intelligence, whether it's BI or analytics. So how do we accelerate usage of data by providing the learnings that the machine can infer faster and better over time to accelerate? So making analytics more real. And you'll see a lot of the BI vendors and analytics vendors invest heavily in those spaces. And we obviously have invested in those spaces historically and will continue to do that. On the other side, the people who want to gain some advantage in that, we will see disruption. We will see some level of people who have gone through organizational optimization, whether it's for cost reduction or acceleration, depending on where they are. How does that fit into their ecosystem? Again, if we talk about the manufacturing floor where we leverage computer vision for relearning and training to provide better management of the things on the floor, whether it's sensors at the edges or again through computer vision, how do they make that real? How do they navigate the marketecture into what's real? And again, at the end user, I think where we will hit some level of resistance is on the privacy. What are you doing with my data? How are you anonymizing my data versus others to get to the insights to make my life as a consumer better? And so those vendors, again, have a harder challenge of saying we will leverage these techniques for good, for, you know, and customer benefit, but in a way that is ethical. Those are the two areas. On the vendor side, we're all in, and most vendors that are doing something right now around AI are doing it in the augmented space, and in the analytics player, we're doing in the machine learning and deep learning, and at the consumer end and at the enterprise. How does that fit in? And that doesn't work the way it used to. And we get into cloud and we get into, well, how I don't deploy it the way I used to. You know, I used to buy software that I would put on machines and use that. Okay, well, now if I really want to leverage machine learning, I need more data and I need data more at the edges. And how do I get that? How do I consume that faster? How do I train that? I don't want to spend money training something and continuing to spend money once I've trained it to deploy it. How do I do that in a more agile way? And that's where the meeting of the two edges happens between the enterprise and the vendors. Mm-hmm. How do we make sure that we deliver things that the enterprise can consume, but again, in a way that's not so complex that they say, well, that's science fiction and I can't do that. But I think that's really the things that we'll really be honing on this year.
Yeah. Well, how do you judge the maturity of enterprises? Because I think the technology is one thing, so this is evolving very fast. Where are the enterprises in different industries? Are they already adopting this from your perspective, or what kind of challenges are they facing in this adoption of this new technologies, which is always a challenge, I guess?
I tend to segment companies in three buckets of maturity. They're along two different axes. There's the analytics maturity, and then there's the technology maturity. And to adopt this technology, depending on where you are in the analytics and technology maturity, you are in different places. I'll take two extreme examples. The financial industry has historically been very analytically mature because of regulatory reasons, right? They've been doing analytics for years, whether it's in risk or fraud or any money laundering, or you can name it. Very much so, but because they've been doing it so long, they're running on most likely legacy technology, whether it's mainframes or data-centric technologies. And they're looking to accelerate through more modern technologies as they look to become more digital and leverage that maturity they have in analytics to go that. And the challenge they're faced with is the way they've done it before is not the way they do it moving forward. So they're ready and primed because they understand what analytics truly means and the cost of that. But they're having to transform because it's not the way they used to do it. On the other side of things, you have the technology mature companies, so the Web 2.0 companies or the more digital native companies, and they're coming into it with a better data savvy because they're born in the data age. But they're looking at these financial institutions going, well, that seems very, very hard. You've spent years or decades building the skill set and technologies to do that. And they're looking at that saying, is that the way I want to do it? And the reality is what the vendors and software in general is saying is, no, you don't have to do it the old way. There's a better, faster way to do that. And it's mostly through technology enablement and a skill set focus. And then you have the people in the middle who kind of don't know where they are and they tackle it different ways. They've maybe hired, you know, tens or hundreds of data scientists to say, well, let's just tackle the problem with humans because we believe this is a coding challenge. Or others that have said, you know what, let me tackle the data problem first. I'm going to follow the path of what the banks and financial services have done historically. Start with the data, get to insights, and get to predictive and AI. And there is no right answer. We believe we can accelerate through automation and AI for those people who are more web, you know, 2.0 native, and we can help the more traditional analytics company accelerate through different ways of consuming technology while leveraging those core skill sets they have, whether they've had them for years or they just brought them in.
That's a good topic. So how can we really help? So what we see at the end of the day is one challenge, obviously, and then there are different surveys from McKinsey and so forth that really this analytics piece is not really entering the workflows in the company. So the decisions are not made. There are nice analytics result, but they are not leveraged throughout the organization in all processes. So thus announced recently $1 billion of investment in this space, artificial intelligence. So what can customers or companies expect from us in the next years regarding this acceleration of adoption of AI from your perspective?
So we made the announcement, and there's it's a lot to decompose. I'll focus on two portions. As I alluded to, there's a skills gap within this marketplace. A lot of our investments are going in to close the skills gap in two components. A, making it more available and educating people on what does it truly mean? How do we get you upskilled to benefit your organization? The other one is by making software more reachable. We've talked about democratization of data and the citizen data scientists for years. We want to make that real. A lot of our investments in making analytics and AI more achievable to the business-centric people and not the technology. So that's one area of focus is in education and really making it available to the masses. And the other one is in embedding analytics into an AI specifically into our technology. We believe, whether it's in data management, data prep, or in the visualization areas and BI, that we can accelerate through AI. A machine can detect patterns in data integration faster over time as it trains to do better data prep. It also can render better insights to take the person who is navigating a visualization or a dashboard and saying, hey, what if you looked at it this way? And if you connect these two things, it provides you better insights. So from a technology standpoint, we are embedding AI within our platform, within our tools, within our solutions. And we're educating people to be able to leverage that and rendering our software easier to access for people not to need to be statisticians or mathematicians or data scientists, for the business analyst and others to come in and leverage the power of the platform and also educate people. This is what it truly means. So those are, from a SaaS standpoint, those are the investments we're making in AI in the next few years.
Okay. Great. So mainly augmenting humans and machines in order to do a better job faster, more efficient, concentrating on the real creative work and so forth. So this is a main headline from my perspective.
Yes.
So if you look at the current very, very transparent discussions we have, especially here in EMEA and in Europe, it's regarding this so-called FAT, fairness, accountability, and transparency. So if a machine decides on whether I get a loan or not or something like this, so this seems to be a problem, obviously, for one hand side for the consumers and on the other hand side, obviously, for regulators to understand that there are machines deciding something which in the past was decided by humans. How do you think can a software vendor like SAS help in this space?
So we have specifically in one domain invested a lot and will continue to invest in interpretability. This is where we can take a black box model, so something that somebody else built, and by running it through machine learning and other mechanics of interpreting that and saying, this is what the model did. This is the data it looked at. This is where it weighted it. This is the decision it based on. Those are the specifically non-SaaS models, right? So we want to open that black box and say, these are the decisions. On the SaaS modeling side, we've provided lineage and information historically. We will continue to do that and provide now natural language generation to make that more consumable by the layman, by somebody who may not understand what a regression is or what a random forest algorithm is. And that, so we are investing heavily in that, in interpretability and natural language generation, to open up the box and say, well, here it is. This is how we remove bias, because one of the biggest fears we have within AI is skew or bias. How do we know that we are not generating a biased answer based on the data that we looked at? The data itself could be biased, right? The data could have been segmented or restricted, or even the holistic nature of it is biased in general. How are we addressing that and making sure that it doesn't exist? And by opening that up and making it human readable and also machine readable, we're making that more fair. We've always invested in data lineage to show that this is where the data came from. We've always tagged, this is where the model is, this is the lineage. We've had to hit the mandates of the regulators in the industry. So we've provided that. What we're doing is accelerating that for other modeling techniques and saying, and here it is, this is how you understand. So you know, as a consumer or as a regulator, this is what happened. This is what was applied to the data. This is the data that was used in private ways to get to the answer. Those are big investments.
Cool. So you mentioned already it's this models built by some other technologies than SAS itself. Mm-hmm. So, and you are coming really from an open source world with Red Hat, obviously, as a leading company there. What's your view on open source and the commercial vendor in this space of artificial intelligence? Which role will each play in the future? How will that look like in the next 3 years?
So we are moving into an and world where it's open source and others. And as a point of clarification, open source is a development methodology, right? It's not necessarily commercial terms. And the Red Hat, the company I came from, is an open source company that commercializes open source. So the development method is open source, but they commercialize it, and they're growing really well and just got acquired. So from our perspective, open source people are leveraging those tools to create projects, whether they're Python libraries or data science projects, and then people want to use those. Where we come in, and we want to encourage people to get into this community of data science and analytics. And if their way into that is through open source tools or open source libraries or open source development, that's awesome, because they're participating in that community. We work within the community. You can write open source with SAS. You can write open source outside of SAS, and SAS help you. And so it's an and conversation of, we believe as a commercial vendor in a proprietary world, that we can accelerate that. We can help you get to an answer beyond just the model, beyond the science experiment, beyond the project to get to a product. And it's a merging of those two to accelerate all. People have invested heavily in data scientists, and we don't necessarily want to retrain them in writing another language. Continue writing the language you have, but SAS can help you accelerate, can help you get to that answer. And others are doing the same. And we just feel we have the horsepower and the know-how and the history in making it real. And open source has a good groundswell of adoption around developers and designers, and we should help them participate in the community of analytics because they can help us understand and do things that we may not necessarily see. There's power in the community, and we want to harness that and accelerate that. And then we're not the only ones. And in the next few years, you know, I think the and conversation will be true. If I look at taking my SaaS hat off for a minute and going back 7 years ago when Microsoft came out and says, Microsoft loves Linux. And, you know, the world has acknowledged an open source world exists. And again, it's a development model and the tools that it produces to go from projects, open source projects, to becoming products. There's a relationship there. And we will participate and continue to participate in this heavily like other vendors have, whether it be Microsoft or IBM or the others in the world that are, you know, participating in the open source community. We will do the same.
Okay, so that was very useful. This comparison, commercialize and from a methodology, open source methodology, how to develop code. So we can expect from also vendors like SAS a more open developed environment, integration of these kind of methods and so forth, which I guess is great for the companies out there in order to accelerate this adoption of AI. So finally, what can you recommend our listeners here in the podcast? If they have a digital transformation ahead, a lot of challenges there, a lot of data, analytics maturity, skill sets and so forth. So what's your recommendation and how to start, how to keep pace with this really high evolving technologies and developments in the market? So what's your tip here?
So I would say don't believe the hype, because the challenges that they're having, everybody is having. Nobody has completely solved this. The very mature are still struggling through transformation and how do we transform legacy. The immature, the ones that are dipping their toe into it, are saying, how do I even get started? And so nobody's falling behind yet. People will start falling behind soon if they don't get started. So the second recommendation is get started. Start small. Don't try to achieve precision, achieve something. Mm-hmm. And understand that when you achieve it, think of day zero, day one, and day two. It's good to build a model. It's good to build a science experiment. Okay, let me see that to the end. Instead of the recommendation I give to most customers is don't start 20 and try to chug all 20 all the way up the stack to an operational flow. Start with one and see it all the way through. How do you get that model deployed to the end and become operational? That's hard. But you now build the brain and the muscles to achieve that repeatedly. That's what I would say. Start small. Try not to achieve complete precision. Good enough is a good place to start. Find the tools and the people that will help you. Tools don't solve it alone. Right? We want to partner with people, and I know others want to, and help you solve those problems together. We've done this before with others that look and feel like you, and maybe we can provide you some insights and try to get to that end-to-end journey. Because if you start too many, then you get bogged down by the complexities of it to try to see it to production and truly day two operations. How to make sure it's always up? How to make sure that the model hasn't, you know, deprecated, or is there a skew in it, or there's a better model out there? So by starting that, I believe you can get to value quicker. And then you could prove those things out both to your regulators and your people who are investing in you to do more, to move beyond the science experiment phase. And I think SAS is a big part to play in that. But I would say We can accelerate, we can help you get started, but don't be frozen by the fear of others have done it and it's really, really hard. It's complex, but again, it is achievable if you slice it small enough to see it to fruition.
Perfect. So the recommendation is focus on the use case and bring it into life and from end-to-end perspective, not generating a lot of use cases in a lab and then it's it. So bring it to the world of bringing it to the decision flow and something like this. So, but with focus, that's our recommendation, yep. Right? Very cool. So thank you, Shadi. That was very, very interesting insights of where we are heading with AI, what are the current developments. So thank you so much for being my guest here. And thanks to all of the listeners here for being my guest in this podcast. And I look forward for the next time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Weitere Informationen zu künstlicher Intelligenz finden Sie im Web unter www.sas.de/ki-kompakt-podcast.